Sometimes when I'm making a video, I have a technique I want to share with you, or a theme. And sometimes I just start playing, usually with some of my newer purchases. That's what happened this week. And as I made the cards, the theme kind of evolved into ideas for using small stamps and how to use some old school tools combined with some newer crafty tools to get some really cool results. I started with this stamp from Technique Junkies. I've been dying to play with this one. I don't know if you know the designer Marimekko, but this stamp reminds me of that, and I knew just inking it up with one color of ink was going to give me the look. I'm using my big Sizzix stamp positioner because I'll need the space in a little while, and I'm opening it backwards, at least for me, because if I open it to the left, it hits my camera. Now, back in the day, red rubber stamps were all we had, and it wasn't so easy to re-stamp if you didn't get a perfectly solid impression on your first try. So being able to use this stamp in a stamp positioner certainly is an improvement over the olden days. And you can just leave this as it is. It's perfectly pretty. But I've got another new set from Technique Junkies called 60s Chic that has all these fun little mid-century shapes and motifs. I grabbed one that I've used before, and I put it down in the center of one of the flowers. I inked it up with some pucker up ink, and I stamped it down. Again, I'm using that positioner in case I need to stamp more than once, but you can do this with an acrylic block. I didn't clean the stamp each time, I just carefully placed it on the next position and picked it up with the stamp positioner, so this was a fun way to combine those two stamp sets. This positioner comes with a set of sticky papers that you put on the base that hold your card in place. They are pretty sticky, and I want to talk about that a little later, but they're also a consumable, so you would need to buy more over time. I thought about trying it out with a grip mat. Because I was already using red rubber stamps with that cushioning on the back, I didn't want to add any more thickness, so I'll try that another day with photopolymer stamps. I love gems and sequins, but I also like the flat look of the ones I make myself with some dies. I usually make them with normal white cardstock that I've inked up, but I wanted a little shine today, so I grabbed some matte silver cardstock. I wanted them to match my stamping, so I also grabbed some Copic markers and I scribbled on the silver. That didn't give me very good results, so I went back and I got my refills for these two Copics, and I created my own alcohol ink backgrounds by putting down a few drops of the refill and then puffing the ink around with this little blower thing. Although the alcohol dried pretty quickly, it was still kind of sticky, so I left it overnight before I came back, and I cut this piece of cardstock with one of the dies from Gina K's Lots of Dots set. I love this one because it has a ton of different sizes of dots. For this card, I trimmed the stamp panel down to cut that stamped frame off, and I stamped a big bold sentiment from Avery Elle in black ink. I only used pink dots since the card was predominantly orange. I love the flat look of them, but there's still that shine that catches the light. For my next card, I used another stamp from the 60s set. This one's geometric, and it's just screaming out to be made of full background. Because of the geometry, I want some precision in my placement, so I pulled out this very old school tool, a stamp-a-majig. Kids, this is what we did pre-Misti. It is a good tool, but it's easier to make errors with this one than with a Misti, so it's not super popular anymore. To use it, you put a piece of acetate into the corner of the tool. Then you stamp your stamp, making sure the acrylic block is also right in the corner of the tool. Now you can move the image on the acetate to wherever you want it, line up the tool, remove the acetate, and then stamp the image onto your panel, and it's in exactly the same spot. Then you can move the acetate along, line it up perfectly with the previous image, add the tool to the corner of the acetate, remove the acetate, and stamp the stamp down again, and so on. Now you can imagine that this takes a little bit of patience, especially with a stamp this small, so I stopped when I had a square panel done. Even now, it's not 100% perfect, but it's certainly better than these two panels I had tried with just freehanding it. For some pops of color, I filled in the open circles with some tiny stamped hearts. I didn't love that, so I went back and I colored them in with the matching Copic markers. Next, I wanted to add a sentiment from my stash. This is an embossed happy birthday from Ink Blot Shop, and it's on a strip, but it's not evenly placed, and it's a little too wide to fit on one of my rows. But it's also difficult to trim a strip this small. To make it easier, I lined up the sentiment, not the edge of the strip, so that it was straight on my cutting mat, and then I used some mint tape to attach a bigger piece of cardstock to the strip. I lined it up so that it was straight along a horizontal line on my glass mat. Now this can act as a handle as I'm die cutting, and I know if I line up the bottom of the white piece, the happy birthday will be straight. See? Then I repeated the process for the top of the strip, trying to make sure I had an even amount of black on the top and bottom of the strip. I hope you can see what I mean. I trimmed down the ends, and then it fit perfectly into one of my rows, and just short by one column on the left, which was the perfect place to put my homemade embellishments. I put an orange dot on the pink circle, a silver one on the black, and then a pink dot onto the orange circle. Now card number three. This is another stamp from that 60s set. It's an open kind of diamond. Because of the way the stamp is cut, it's very easy to place it right in the center of my acrylic block, and that helped me line it up on my panel of cardstock. This shape helps to create one of my all-time favorite patterns. I don't know if it has a name or not, but I love how by using this pointy shape, you actually create this kind of circle pattern, and it really has a feel of the 60s, I think. You could use the Stamp-O-Majig to line them up point to point, but I really like the airy feel of this more open stamping. Plus, it was just easier. The set also has a solid stamp with the same shape, so I filled in each of the outlines with either the pink or the orange, and again, I just eyeballed it, not really worrying about whether it was precisely lined up. I think it gives almost a cartoon kind of feel. For this one, I went back to the Avery Elle set for a big congrats. I centered the round O over top of one of the diamonds, and then I added a mix of orange and pink embellishments. My next card shows a simple method for helping you line up a pattern you're trying to create on a card with a small stamp. Just use a stencil. This one is from Catherine Pooler Designs, and it's meant to be used in a planner to create a month. I used another couple of stamps from the 60s set. These are kind of groovy flowers or starfish or something. I stamped one in each circle, and I turned the stamp each time for some variety. Now there's another similar stamp, so I used that and the pink ink over top, again turning to try and allow the orange underneath to be visible. It's fun. It's kind of groovy, as I said. But I decided to add some black and I grabbed this funny stamp. I don't know, maybe it looks too much like a virus, but I do think it kind of looks neat with the pink and orange behind it. This time I wanted silver embellishments and I wanted them all the same size. And for that, I have another favorite die, the signature polka dot cover plate from a Jillian Vance design. I trimmed the panel down to allow some more white space on the card, and I added one to the center of each flower virus, and then I used some of the really tiny pink and yellow ones around my hello sentiment. Next, I grabbed another kind of small stamp. This one's a strip from a background stamp from Simon Hurley. It's got that diamond shape that I love, and it's going to give me the opportunity to show you what I think is the best feature of this stamp positioner, and that's its size. I put my cardstock very precisely on my sticky mat. This time I'm going to move the panel along and stamp the stamp to create my pattern. I measured the stamp and it's slightly less than 3/4 inch, but I'm going to move the paper by 3/4 inch each time to make it easy to use the grid on my mat. If I had measured more precisely and moved the cardstock that amount, the images would be closer together and the pattern would have been tighter, but you really have to weigh that against the work involved in trying to measure more precisely. I found that it was helpful to put down a piece of washi tape along the top of the panel so I didn't have to worry about lining my panel up with the grid at the top, just along that right side as I moved it along. And in the end, my looser, more open pattern left me some room to grab another of the strip stamps and repeat the process, this time with some black ink. I was really just having fun playing with these stamps and building different patterns. When they come apart like this, there's so many possibilities. To finish this one, I grabbed a solid thanks sentiment, and I lined it up on the panel along the line of black dots. Then I stamped it and moved the panel and stamped again. It was that same measurement of 3/4 inch that I had used for the other two stamps, even though I was moving vertically this time. Before we go any further, I did want to say that one thing I noticed with this sticky mat is that it definitely leaves a sticky residue on my cardstock, which I did not like. But when I rubbed over it with my hand, it really just came off in bits. You could use an adhesive eraser as well, so that's an extra step, but it's not fatal, if you know what I mean. To finish this one, I trimmed down the panel to leave a nice big white border, and I added one silver embellishment just to the left of each of the thanks sentiments. Man, I was really getting into a groove. There's just a couple left, but now I started combining everything I had left on my desk. I started with yet another strip die. This one has these kind of asterisk things, and I centered that on my panel. Next, I grabbed this kind of outline oval from the 60s set. I centered it on my acrylic block and I started stamping around each of the little stars. I was getting lazy by this point and I did not want to try for precision. So I just stamped across the row and then I came back with the orange ink, again turning the stamp a little so that both colors were visible. I liked the look that I had kind of just doodled around the black stars, so I added a couple more layers until I was happy with it. I had no idea how to finish this one, whether I should put the sentiment above or below the doodle, but that Avery Elle set gave me an idea. I performed some stamp surgery to cut the happy away from the birthday, and I did both. I think it's kind of fun. And of course, I added some of my homemade dots to the centers for a bit of shine. For my final card, I used my stamp wheel. I removed the clear mat since I'm using red rubber stamps, which was something I hadn't done before, and I used some temporary adhesive on the back of my cardstock to hold it in place. I've got numbers on my stamp wheel to make it easier for me to remember what I've already stamped and what comes next. So I placed the open oval stamp where I wanted it on the lid. There's grooves there so you can see how close you are to the next line, and I did want a little bit of overlap. And I also wanted the pattern to fully fit on my cardstock. There are 16 turns on the stamp wheel and I wanted alternating colors, so I inked up the stamp and then I placed the lid down so that the number one was at the bottom center position. Then I picked up the lid, inked up the stamp again, placed it down so that number three was at the bottom center. Then five, then seven, and so on. Like the other stamp positioners, this one allows you to restamp in the precise same spot if you need to. Once I had the eight orange petals, I cleaned the stamp, inked it up again, and then put the lid down so that two was in the bottom center. Then four, then six, then eight, etc. You could clean the stamp each time and work your way through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, switching your orange and yellow ink all the way to 16, but I found it easier to do all of one color at a time. To finish this card, I stamped the big thank you from the Avery Elle set, and I centered that round O in the center of the flower. Then it felt a bit unbalanced, so I grabbed You're the Best stamp from the Ink Blot set, and I stamped that underneath. I think the two of them worked perfectly together, and that was a fun discovery. I trimmed the panel with a circle die and added three little embellishments in the center to finish it off. Well, that was a bit of a mishmash, wasn't it? What's your favorite old school tool? Were you around in the days of woodblock stamps and stamp-a-ma-jigs? Let me know in the comments below. And remember, I've still got that discount code for Technique Junkies for 10% off your purchase. I've put it in the description below. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time.